Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. It's good to see you all this morning. If you are tuning in online, it's good to have you folks with us live streaming. We'd like to welcome you to Long Memorial United Methodist Church on this ninth Sunday after Pentecost. If you would notice the announcements that are printed in your bulletin, I think that's all the announcements that I have to say, so I'm not going to read to you, but if you would, sometime during the service, glance at those announcements. In the last couple of weeks, we've discussed our personal need for God's healing and renewal. Today, we recall that God's invitation for renewal is primarily to a community, the community of God's holy people. We cannot choose the time and the place of our lives, but we can choose how to live in those times, whether they're good or whether they're bad. Think about our community you're a part of, be it family or church or nation, how God is calling us to be faithful in spite of the difficulties we may undergo. I invite you to sit with that question as we listen to our prelude. Would you please join me in our call to worship, which you can find printed in your bulletin. Come away and rest for a while. Leave behind your busyness to be fully present to God. God's steadfast love surrounds us here. We are reminded of God's enduring faithfulness. We have a covenant with our Creator. This is the time for renewal of our promises.
God calls for righteousness and justice. God offers us goodness and mercy all
Let us pray. Rock of our salvation, we have accepted the invitation of Jesus to gather as your beloved people. We have been far away from you in our thoughts and separated from you in much of that we do. Now we are here together, seeking reconciliation with you and one another. We call on your steadfast love for assurance and healing. We feel your compassion for us and for all your children. We sense your longing for our wholeness and renewed faith and trust. You call us to be saints. We are overwhelmed even as you draw us close. Grant us renewal from our overwhelmedness. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able as we join together singing our opening hymn, number 140 in your hymnal, Great is Thy Faithfulness. I invite you to join me in our affirmation of faith, which you can find on page 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Peace of Christ with one another.
In your bulletins. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. I'm going to be reading from the prophet Jeremiah. This is his letter to the Jews who were taken into exile in Babylon. I'm going to begin chapter 29. I'm going to begin in verse 4. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let the prophets and diviners who are among you deceive you, and do not listen to the dreams that they dream, for it is a lie that they are prophesying to you in my name. I did not send them, says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then when you call upon me and come and pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me if you seek me with all your heart. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Give me Jesus.
I'm going to invite the children to come down, and there is no statute of limitations on age for children's time, and I have something really good to give away, so all children, any age, come on down. So, some of you scientists out there, I got something here. Now, we've got wood, right? And we've got rocks. And some of these rocks are almost like handmade, like they're from maybe marble columns or something like that. So what's older, the wood or the rocks? Think the seashell might be the big rock, but all the rocks are going to be older than the wood, right? Because even if this is from a really old tree, it's probably only a few hundred years old. But these things They are thousands and thousands and thousands of years old. That, I think, is a piece of, like, pottery or something.
It's like a dinosaur tooth.
Think it's a dinosaur tooth? Well, let me tell you where I got these. These all come from the Sea of Galilee. And that is a place on the other side of the world where Jesus walked. And because rocks are so old, it may be that these rocks are something that Jesus picked up when he was walking. Because you always pick up rocks and shells and stuff when you're walking on the beach, right? So he might have picked these up. He might have picked up a shell. He might have picked up this stone and thought, that is a nice one. Yeah, shark tooth? Yeah? You like dinosaurs? Eh, not sure. You like cars.
Like a baby T-Rex tooth.
That's like a baby T-Rex tooth. Obviously, I should have brought teeth. Well, let me tell you something. These are so old, and these are things that Jesus might have picked up. So I'm going to let you all pick a rock or a shell, and you can keep it, and you can tell important people that this is from the Sea of Galilee that Jesus walked, and maybe Jesus picked it up. Because sometimes we need to remember, you want something? That God's story is very, very old. You guys want one? All right, let's say a prayer. How do we do it? One, two, three. Holy God, help us to remember that your story is a really big story, and help us to figure out where our place is in it. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Let y'all go back and sit with your parents. I know that's boring, but life is like that sometimes. Please pray with me. Lord, your story is a big story. This earth is a big earth. And there are so many people and nations and problems that it gets overwhelming for us. Help us to find our place in your big, big story. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, most of you know all of this, but let me provide you with just a little bit of context for this scripture in Jeremiah that we read today. There are three great events in the life of the nation of Israel. The first is the call of Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. Abraham is called by God. God says, go to the place I send you and you will find a wonderful land and I will make your descendants as many as the stars in the sky or the sands on the beach. And Abraham went. That's why we still consider him the avatar of faith, because he went when God asked him to. And of course, then God is giving God's blessing and choosing a family, a tribe of people, to become God's chosen people. And that goes on throughout the book of Genesis. And then we see those assorted tribes, which have grown and grown and grown, become enslaved in Egypt. And so the second great event in the life of the people of Israel is the Exodus, when Moses goes at God's calling to free the slaves in Egypt. He speaks to Pharaoh. He leads them out through the Red Sea and into the desert, where they wander for 40 years trying to learn how to become a nation. And then God makes this nation, Israel, his chosen people. But as is the way of human beings, God's chosen people kind of lose their way. The pinnacle of the time in the promised land is with the reign of David, and then it begins to kind of slide, first with Solomon, and then with Solomon's sons who divide the kingdom in two. And the people of Israel, they make two mistakes, according to the prophet Isaiah. First of all, they get enmeshed in idolatry. They're setting up idols on all the hills. And the second thing they do is they forget to care for the poor. It says they build house to house and land to land. The people who are wealthy become wealthier, and the poor and the widowed and the orphans and the immigrants become neglected. And for these sins, after warning, after warning, after warning, which of course the people don't really take very seriously, God finally raises up Babylon that comes and destroys them. The northern kingdom, the kingdom of Israel, is destroyed a couple hundred years earlier, and then the southern kingdom. And its destruction is complete in 587 BC. When the Babylonians razed Jerusalem to the ground. This is in multiple historical sites that there is nothing left in Jerusalem, no wall, no houses, and certainly not Solomon's great temple. And the king is, he's blinded after having to watch his own sons get murdered, and then the people of Jerusalem get carted away into Babylon. This is a crisis for Israel, not only a crisis of being exiles in a foreign land, but it is a theological crisis because they have to ask themselves, what happened to God's promises? God promised that we would have land, we'd have a beautiful land, it would be our land, and now it's been destroyed. What happened to the promises of God? And into this dislocation of the people of Israel, Jeremiah sends this letter with these famous words: God has a plan for you, and it's a plan to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope. Now, those readers is a college organization that came about after World War II. There were a couple of, I don't know if they were Navy men, I think, or aviators, but they ended up in a Japanese prisoner of war camp, and they discovered that they didn't know very much of the Bible, and the Japanese didn't let them have Bibles, and they were hungry for scripture. And so they embarked on this ministry and mission to teach children to memorize scripture. And it really was wonderful. I did learn a lot of scripture and kind of developed a love of memorizing scripture. And the older you get, just want to say it's a really good exercise to pick something and memorize it, because it helps your brain. But we memorized a lot of scripture, and a lot of it we put to music. I will never forget, you know, Titus 3:12. You can do it to the tune of, I've been working on the railroad. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Ghost. By the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Ghost. Titus 3:12, King James Version. See, I never forgot it. That's what happens, you put scripture to music. But I learned a lot of scripture. And for the first time, I heard this scripture, but unfortunately, I didn't know that I was reading it wrong. I thought, as I did much of scripture, that it was self-referential, that it was talking about me. But of course, God is speaking to who? A community. He's speaking to God's people who are in the midst of this horrible, horrible situation. And I think that's important for us to understand because, you know, God's plan is a really big plan. I mean, it spans, you know, from prehistory, from the creation of the earth, the creation of human beings, the Garden of Eden. It goes through the call of Abraham and into through all the Old Testament and the coming of Jesus 2,000 years ago. And God's plan is still going on. So the question for us is, how do we find our place in that big, big plan of God? How do we find our place? Because we may grow up in a community where things are prosperous and we're at peace. We may have healthy bodies and live to a ripe old age, but we may not. We may grow up in a place where we're dirt poor. We may grow up in a land that is at war. We may grow up with disabilities such that it's hard to know, where's my place in this big plan? So when I was part of the Navigators, we had these times when we would go out and evangelize on our campus. And I was at the University of Wisconsin, which is a really, really big campus. It's bigger than UNC. So we had a lot of people to talk to. So there was a group of us, maybe 25, 30 of us, and we would gather together in one of the campus rooms, and we would, you know, receive orders. You're going to go to this dorm. You're going to go to this dorm. We'd go up to different dorms. Well, there was one young lady there, part of our group, and she couldn't go with us because she had severe cerebral palsy. She was in a wheelchair. She couldn't speak very well. She couldn't do very much with her hands. Her mind was perfect. But what she could do was pray. So as soon as we all got deployed to all of us various places to evangelize other college students, she would go to her room, she would get on her knees, and she would start praying. And she would pray for each of us by name, and she would pray for the people we were going to encounter, and she would pray that the Holy Spirit would be in all of those conversations so that there would be blessing for the people that we talked to and for the whole campus. And, you know, I don't remember anything about anybody in our group except for her. She made such an impression on me because her faith was so strong and she did such a powerful thing. In spite of her disability, she knew that her place in our group, her place in God's story, was a place of prayer. That was what she could do, and she was going to do it faithfully. See, I think that's the secret to finding our place in God's story, is to not pay as much attention as we might to the circumstances of our individual lives, but instead think about, why did God put me in this place right here today? What is God calling me to do right here today? Where is my place in this big story? Because we can't know the outcomes that God is planning, right? Other than that it's going to be good in the end. Jana said, what'd your father say, Jana?
My husband says, God will have the last word and it will be good.
God will have the last word and it will be good. Other than that, we don't know the details. We don't know, you know, who's going to be elected in November. We don't know whether there's war in the future. We don't know what our bank accounts are going to look like. Inflation is going to keep going up. We don't know what's going to happen to our bodies and our families. We don't know any of those things. But we know that God has a plan. God has the last word. And it's going to be good. So all we can do is to try to find our place. Try to find a way to claim who we are in the midst of that big plan. And remember that it's not all about us. I'm still that spoiled kid that my parents raised, and my husband occasionally has to say, honey, it's not all about you. And that's a good word for all of us, I think. And we can find, no matter where we are, we can find moments of beauty. I love in the movie Forrest Gump how there's a scene where Forrest has been in combat in Vietnam, and it's been horrible. He's seen horrible things. And somebody says, what was it like in Vietnam? And he said, oh man, it was horrible. And he said, well, but there were those moments. He says, there were those moments when the rain would stop and I'd look up through the jungle and I'd see the clouds moving apart and I would see a circle of stars. You know, we can find those moments all the time. Amen? We can find them if we're in the hospital. We can find them in the midst of family difficulties. We can find them in the midst of poverty. We can find moments that are beautiful and remind us that God is moving that big, beautiful plan forward. We can remember that God has a really good plan. I had a friend. I worked with him as my associate for a number of years. He was a teenager when the genocide in Rwanda broke out. And he survived, although nobody else in his family did. And he ended up in a refugee camp in Congo. And he lived in a tent. And he said every day they were given 5-gallon bucket containers and they could trek about a mile down the mountainside to the lake, fill their bucket with 5 gallons of water, and take it up to a town where they could get 2 sweet potatoes for it. And he said, you know, it was the worst of times, and yet there were so many moments when I realized that God was there. God was there watching out for me as I'd survived this terrible thing, and God had a plan for me to be part of his story. And he went to South Africa. He became part of a refugee ministry and came to the United States and became a pastor here. His life had changed a lot, although we had a vacation Bible school once where we put up tents for the kids. And he said, you will never get me in a tent again. Could not understand why Americans thought that that was a good thing to do. But God had a place for him in God's big story. And he influenced lives, influenced my life. God's plan is a good plan. And next week we will talk about where God's plan ends, and we will talk about how to get on board with the ending of God's plan, which is for all things, nature, all creation, all people, to be redeemed. Amen and amen. On our prayer list today, we have Dan Butler. I don't know whether he's home yet or not. I think he's doing a little bit better and may be home. Conrad Kimbrough, Alicia Puryear, Jim Owen, Tom Hill Clayton, and Paula Gentry Siegel. We've also had a request to add Jimmy Winslow. Are there others that we need to keep in our prayer list? Yes. Linwood Strickland. Is that one word, Linwood? Are there others?
My brother Steve Westenberger.
Bill's brother Steve. He's having some problems with his new liver. Transplants are tenuous things sometimes. Lord, in your mercy. Are there others? Let's continue to pray for Ed. Last I talked to him, he was up on Montana and the Blackfoot Nation with a friend, and I think he's planning to come back. But continue to pray for him. You know, three weeks into a renewal leave, you just finally start to relax. And so please pray that the Holy Spirit will be giving him all the energy and strength that he needs to find his way back to us. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we ask that you would pour out your grace on people all over the world that are suffering, people who live in places like Ukraine and Israel and Gaza and Yemen, people in countries whose names we can barely pronounce. But Lord, they are beloved by you, and we ask that you would raise up people and resources to help them. Most of all, Lord, give them moments of beauty and moments when they sense the presence of your love. We pray for all those who have lost loved ones, for those who are suffering a time of grief. Show us ways that we can care for them. And most of all, Lord, just help us to be people who listen to your voice as you shepherd us into a story that is bigger and more beautiful than we ever could have imagined. And we offer up the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Now let us worship God with his tithes and our offerings. I invite the ushers to come forward, please.
Thank you.
Almighty God bless the gifts that have been given. Take them out into your world so that your story may go forward in a strong and dynamic way for your people. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to continue standing as you are able. We're going to be singing a great song about getting into God's story, Forward Through the Ages, number 555.
Son and Holy Spirit. Amen.